what is our typical time frame as far as go to market?
How long is it? That's a great question. It could be as few as a day, and as much as a few weeks. You know, I mean, ideally we would have a few weeks, but I mean, the reality is in this space, if you spend weeks or even months planning out something, I mean, it may no longer be relevant.
Today on the show, we have Eric Lee. Eric Lee is the creative director, a Renaissance man, fully bearded, looking excellent most of the time. Eric, how are you doing this afternoon?
Hey, Patrick, I'm doing well, thanks. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Excited to have you on the show. I feel like there's a lot of really good stuff that we're going to be able to cover today. So before we get started, I have to know, tell me a little bit about what you do to help advisors on the creative side of the business.
Great question. I think in general, the financial space is sort of a wasteland of creativity. I think it tends to skew very corporate and sterile in the sort of design elements that people pump out. And so what I really have found useful is kind of getting back to the core of humanity in a way, and the way that we market financial services. And so, you know, part of my job as the creative director is really to help advisors connect with people, connect with their stories, connect with the reality of their lives that advisors can help sort of change and improve.
You mentioned something really important there, the idea of connection. I feel like that's being lost in today's environment. There's so much noise on every single social platform. Everybody wants the latest tip and tactic in order to get somebody's attention and get a new client. But I feel like the idea of human connection is being lost in social media and interaction. People are just starting to, you know, almost rebel against it. Do you feel like are you bullish, to use a financial term that you're probably not familiar with? I mean, do you look favorably upon the idea of human connection being a critical aspect of the financial advice process and business moving forward? What are your thoughts on the idea of the human connection?
Yeah, I think it's not only you know, a good thing. I think it's a crucial thing, honestly. I think as we have grown, quote unquote, more connected via technology and you know, social media platforms, in reality, what we've really sort of set up for ourselves is these isolated islands of life and reality that actually are very disconnected.
Yeah.
And so I think, you know, part of the goal is to help us, or help advisors really connect with people. I mean, this business was started as a personal thing, as a connection, you know, between a person and their advisor. And, you know, taking that into the digital age, I think it's skewed really far the other direction. And now we're kind of, what we found as a company is we've got to re-harness that connection with people so that they have the opportunity to actually connect with people and to actually make a meaningful or build a meaningful relationship that they can actually use or leverage in their business.
Agreed. I feel like the idea of the relationship, building the actual relationship through social, through design, through the written word, is something that a lot of advisors, frankly, don't understand and don't invest enough in. What are your thoughts as far as a lot of advisors want to redesign their website, or they're looking for the best website they can possibly have? What do you feel advisors need to be thinking about when they pay someone, or they, let's say, do it on their own and design a website that could potentially build a relationship with someone in the financial space?
Yeah, you probably saw me cringe when you said do it on their own. I think, you know, I think really the biggest advice I could give to an advisor that's, you know, that's either rebranding or rebuilding a website or building maybe from scratch to begin with is simplification. I think we tend to put way too much information, particularly in the form of text and copy, into websites that, frankly, people are not going to read.
Yeah,
I mean, people don't read really at all. You know, more and more people are consuming content on mobile devices and on, you know, on iPads and iPhones and whatever else they may be using. And, you know, ultimately, you need to have visual elements that tell the story of who you are as an advisor, who you are as a, you know, as a team of of advisors and as a financial firm. And ultimately, you know, you're looking for ways to include elements on there, particularly visually, that connect with your target audience. So, yeah, you know, if that's a specific demographic of people, if it's a specific company, whatever it may be, it's an opportunity that you can quickly, before they even have to read anything, connect with people that they'll help kind of, that helps them sort of insert themselves into your business and say, ah, this is somebody that yeah, gets me, you know,
using effective storytelling and imagery to get mm-hmm. somebody to actually understand where you're coming from and not exactly. put yourself front and center. Because what I found being in the industry is a lot of advisors and firms, they want to position themselves as the hero of the story. We have CFAs, CFPs, we've got a million years of experience and we can solve all your problems, but they don't do a good job of explaining why those problems even need to be solved in the first place, right? What are your thoughts on story? Because I know for our website with SurePath, you and I had collaborated on this a couple months back, we were thinking through, how do we best demonstrate what we do? Like, what's a way that we can lay out the process that we use to help folks without sitting there and saying we do this, then that, then this, and making their head, you know, making their eyes roll back in their head, right?
Right, exactly. Yeah,
we settled on this idea of fictional stories. So, what are your thoughts on like case studies, fictional stories as a way to convey information and those types of things?
Yeah, I think story is powerful. I mean, there's all kinds of camps, and you know, especially I think story is a very sort of buzzword right now in the marketing mm-hmm. space. But I mean, I think there's a reason. I think, you know, at our very core, we are all looking to have a meaningful existence, you know, a meaningful story of our own. And so I think, you know, when we did, I mean, you referenced the new SurePath site, and when we did sort of develop the copy for that, we did think about ways, you know, how can we explain sort of a stereotypical or an example client experience working with us. And what that does is then that allows, you know, somebody out there who's maybe looking for an advisor or someone who has an advisor that they're not really connecting with.
Yeah.
It gives them an opportunity to sort of insert themselves into that story, into this sort of hypothetical situation, and really see the value that we can bring to the table. And so I think that's why it's so powerful. Story is just powerful. I mean, period. And you're right. I think in this space in particular, people have positioned themselves as advisors, as the hero of the story. And that's not what people want. People want to,
yeah,
you know, people want to be the hero of their own story, and they don't necessarily want somebody. I mean, I think, yes, obviously they want help, but you know, ultimately they need somebody to help guide them, not to like, you know,
yeah,
take over and make them feel like a loser.
Well, that's another thing. Like when you and I first started working together a couple of years ago, when I was telling you what I did, you really had no idea. I mean, most advisors think that the consumer audience has a sense of what a fiduciary is, or understands what financial planning means, or investment management, what that means and how that term is relevant to them. I told you that I was a financial advisor, and I said one more word and you were already like,
yeah, my eyes already,
I got
glazed
nothing
over,
yeah, for you.
Yeah, I remember that. And still to this day, it's so funny. I carry around some earmuffs and just put them on if we're in meetings that, you know, we don't need it's like topics, yeah, that I don't necessarily. And I think that there's value in that for me as an outsider of the industry, because I really do have eyes that are what the average consumer has. I mean, yes, there's going to be people out there that have, you know, they know the lingo and the, yeah, acronyms and the, you know, all this stuff. That's just like, for me, it just makes my skin crawl. But you know, there's value in kind of having that outside perspective and really trying to simplify this enough that, you know, mm-hmm, Joe Blow on the street can connect with it and realize, oh, okay. I mean, it's kind of the idea of you give them enough to know that they don't know, and yep, then help them see that they need help. And then there's a lot of value in that.
I agree. Pardon the interruption, friends, but I got some cool stuff to share with you. It's available on modelfa.com. It's a podcast, a blog, videos, resources, and all this really cool stuff that you don't even know about because you're not there. It's available at modelfa.com. Make sure that you check it out, watch some stuff. You're going to learn how to grow your practice, scale it, and just generate more profit so that you can do whatever you want with your time. So we'll see you there. I feel like we've been tremendously successful in that for a couple reasons. One is I am in the industry, so I can understand where they're at from a financial perspective and where the transition points lie, so we can create an effective marketing strategy or attraction process. And then I take, you know, you and the copywriters and everyone else and pull that together in a, you know, create a strategy that combines the context that you need in order to get the business message across, but also meet the person where they're at because they really don't understand the nature of the business. So taking those two and combining them together.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think that's why, you know, we're unique in this marketing space for advisors and really why we've seen the powerful success for our clients that we have, because we have the kind of the best of both worlds. We have, you know, the best in the marketing industry, you know, period, whatever space we're in. But then you're right, you do have the perspective of, you know, having that financial background. And, you know, we have a place to test everything that we offer people. You know? And
you got the lab.
Yeah, exactly. It is. It's very much, you know, it is very much like a lab where we, you know, and we constantly, I mean, you know this, but we constantly change things. I mean, on the fly. You know, if we throw something out there in the marketing space, you know, on a social platform or wherever that's not working, we can quickly adapt. On a dime, we can adapt, you know, whereas most people have to go through, you know, sort of the proverbial hoops, you know, they have to jump through the hoops to make changes, and we can just do it in an instant. And there's a lot of power in that.
I agree. Yeah. The flexibility to be able to pivot and test new things. Most firms could spend weeks, months thinking about ways where they might be able to go to market and test something. But if you can pull together the resources and get a product out there. And that's another thing that I think we should talk about is this idea of quickly testing ideas and not getting so committed that you're doing a strategy, you're walking down the path of doing a strategy for 3 to 6 months that may not convert. Like, what is our typical time frame as far as go to market?
That's a great question. It could be as few as a day, and as much as a few weeks. You know, I mean, ideally we would have a few weeks, but I mean, the reality is in this space, if you spend weeks or even months planning out something, I mean, it may no longer be relevant.
Yeah.
And it may no longer even resonate with people. And so the value of being able to turn on a dime is huge. I mean, I can think of several times where you're like, we need to get an ad out tomorrow. And so, you know, I sit down and wherever the creative juices come from, they show up, and, you know, and we pump something out. And you know, sometimes those are the best things, is those items that we have come up with on the fly. It's sort of, you know, I guess necessity is the mother of invention, as I say. But I mean, it's true. I mean, sometimes, you know, in the heat of the moment, we can really create something and that connects with people and that they actually resonate with.
The other thing is, when we first got started, it was really just you and I trying to figure out what ideas would be best and create and cobble things together. So it's like you and I working multiple hours a day, piecing things together, testing ideas. And then it started to expand into copywriting. Now we have design services. Now we have copy editing. We have funnel experts. We have all this stuff. And what I've realized is, if you don't have a team, it's almost like a fool's errand to try and do marketing, because it requires such a complex skill set. You need strategy, you need execution, you need creative, and then you need like a badass project manager to tie everything together and actually get something that works and you can get out to the marketplace.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's definitely, it is not for the faint of heart, or for the unorganized, or sort of the people who are unwilling to be flexible, because it is a ever changing thing. And you're right. I mean, we would sit down and crank out, you know, ridiculous amounts of copy, and, you know, and then I would take it and throw some design on top of it. And, you know, I look back at that and think, how in the world did we even survive those months? But here we are. And it's incredible just to see, you know, you're right. Bringing in people that have expertise in things that maybe you can do, but they can do it better than you I think that's first of all, it's a sign of a good leader. It's a sign of somebody who's not afraid to say, hey, I need help. You know, I'm not the best at everything, because you're not, nobody is.
Yeah.
and there's, you know, there's a lot of value in that. And it's really allows you to sort of have the flexibility to actually do what you do best. and really sore. Yeah.
I think you're trying to butter me up on the air here. You angling for a pay increase or
always, always.
I think that's a really important, if we could segue there, the idea of trying not to do everything yourself, because I feel like the flavor of the month in financial advice right now is leave your current company, set up your own firm, stand up a website using a WordPress template for $2,000, write your own web copy, try and build a funnel, fail miserably, start blogging, fail miserably. And eventually, once the bank account starts to get to a point where maybe the point of no return, let's call it, the HELOC point, your options become really limited. So what would be your advice to a financial advisor who has either started a business recently or is thinking about leaving where they're currently at and starting a business? How should they think about creating their brand and investing in marketing?
I think the first step is really what I mentioned earlier. It's, you know, admitting that you need help is step one. And realizing that, I mean, there's a reason that advisors became an advisor, and it's not because they like marketing, you know, and it's not because they like to build websites or they like to write copy or any of those other things.
If they do, they can come to work with us. Exactly, we're hiring. Exactly. Let's go.
Exactly. But, you know, there's room for somebody to step in and help. And, you know, and I think that's the beauty of what we've built as a consulting and coaching company is we can give them the tools that they need to maybe do those things that they're not the best at. But then there's also, you know, we have tools where they can, or the opportunities where they can step in and sort of give the reins over to us and they can let somebody else sort of, not, I don't want to say drive their ship, but they can let somebody else hold the wheel while they're navigating, I guess, is kind of a way to look at it. So,
and we've encountered some strange situations, even when advisors choose to, let's say, invest in their brand, in their website. One in particular, I'll call it the plastic surgery effect. They write the check, they decide to hire someone to help them with their website, put together their brand, they get a finished product. It's amazing. And then the plastic surgery effect.
Yeah. And the problem is if you hire people that, you know, they're claim to be experts in, you know, lead magnets or claim to be an expert in, you know, web copy or whatever it may be, they may or may not be great at what they do. Chances are they're probably not. But even if they are, if you're throwing that into the mix of a bigger strategy for your business, it's not going to all work together.
Yeah.
And so you're exactly right. We've seen clients where we've built, I mean, to this day, it's like one of the best things I've ever created. It was beautiful photography. Down. It was like beautiful, but copy, simple, direct, like absolutely like amazing. And it's gone. I mean, it has literally been destroyed.
If I was cultured, I would create some type of a metaphor to explain it. But I think
your plastic surgery metaphor works because it really is, you know, they saw, or somebody told them probably that something could be better. And so then it changes and then it starts this snowball effect. And then before you know it, we've got this like mangled mass of marketing that it doesn't say anything. It doesn't connect with anyone. And it's just garbage, really. Yeah. I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous. And so that's the danger in pulling little bits and pieces of ideas from multiple sources, particularly multiple sources that are not experts in this industry. Yeah. Because there's a lot of quote unquote marketing experts out there, but they have no idea how to connect with people in the financial space.
Oh, it's hilarious. I mean, the flavor of the month right now is this idea of I can provide 50 leads, 50 or 100 leads. What does that even mean? if we're talking about the human connection and relationships, 50, how you can't even talk to 50 and get to know 100 people a year. I have like five friends, five friends. How am I going to talk to 50 to 100 people and get them to a point where they're comfortable enough with me as a human to give me their money in any given month? I mean, it's ridiculous, but advisors fall for this every single day. What do you feel is a reasonable expectation around, let's say, what a brand, a reasoned marketing strategy, and solid advice and tactics, what can that deliver for a financial advisor if they were set that up the right way?
I mean, I think to start off, you know, you're looking at, I mean, if you're getting 1 to 2 meaningful connections a month, I mean, I think it's huge. I mean, you know, down the road, if you're getting, you know, 5 or 6, but you're right. I mean, the idea of really getting to or really getting to know, or really building a meaningful relationship with, you know, 50 to 100 people a year is crazy.
I wouldn't even want to talk to someone if they didn't know who I was about their money. Like, if they had no context on who I was or any of the stuff that I could potentially do or how I could help them, like, that would just be an awkward conversation.
Yeah.
Like, arm wrestling match during the meal. Stupid.
Exactly.
So we're going to go ahead and wrap up. Eric Lee, creative director, thank you so much for being on the show. You are the man, the myth, the legend, the Renaissance man, the bearded bandit. I could go on. Thank you again for coming on the show, sir.
My pleasure, Patrick. Thanks for having me.
All right.